Chondrites contain abundant mineralogically zoned chondrules. Now these chondrules in the core have olivine, which is surrounded by a layer of low calcium pyroxene. These here are two backscatter electron images here, and on this it's quite hard to spot whether these are zoned or not. On the left one, it looks like there's no zonation at all, while on the right one, there is a darker rim which might be or indicate a zonation. Now, when we use a scanning electron microscope or electron microprobe, we can make element maps of these kind of objects. And from these element maps, we can produce phase maps. On a phase map, we can assign the different phases, minerals, a certain false color. So in this case, we will assign the olivine red and the pyroxene blue. And here I overlaid the phase map with the backscatter electron image, so you can really immediately see where these are zoned or not. And this is what I will show here. And you can see it's very easy to spot that in both cases, there's the red core, and these red cores are surrounded by the blue, by the low calcium pyroxene rim. So these are both zoned chondrules, difficult to spot in backscatter electron image, but very easy to spot here when we use these phase maps. Now the question is how many of these zoned chondrules exist? And this is shown in this plot here. This is a category plot with on the x-axis being the various categories. In this case, these are the chondrite groups. On the y-axis is the fraction of zoned chondrules among all the chondrules in a chondrite. And we can immediately see a couple of differences, but also similarities. For example, the carbonaceous chondrites have a large fraction of these zoned chondrules of about 75%. This is lower in the ordinary chondrites with 40% and enside 31%. And ours have almost 50%, while the case only have about 7% here. Now, all these data are 2D data, which means we look in a thin section for the zoned chondrules and simply count them. However, we might make a mistake because we are cutting the chondrules. And here I want to illustrate what this error might basically produce. So let's assume we have a chondrule here with this red olivine core, which is surrounded by a blue pyroxene, very dark blue pyroxene rim. Now when we then cut this chondrule in the middle, so now you're looking from the side onto this chondrule, if we cut it here and then have a section, we see a nice zoned chondrule. However, when we cut the chondrule here, we will only see sort of maybe porphyritic pyroxene chondrule or something like this, but not a zoned chondrule. So when we look at 2D and we section a chondrule here, we will not identify it as a zoned chondrule. So if we count these in 2D, we'll make a certain error. It is then possible to also basically count mineralogical zoned chondrules in 3D when we, for example, take a thick section, serial section is thick section, and then we will find all the zoned chondrules. And when we do this, so count the real 3D fraction, we find that this is about 20 to 80% higher. 20% in the case of carbonaceous and ordinary chondrites, but in case of ensite chondrites, it's up to 80% higher. The reason for this is that ensite chondrites have very thick rims, and therefore we very often section this rim. So ensite chondrites, in fact, might have something like maybe 40, 50% zoned chondrules. So in summary, the zoned chondrules are very abundant in all the chondrites, and maybe even in all the chondrites, the dominant chondrule type. Maybe not in ordinary chondrites, but likely in the others, except for the K chondrites. This mineralogical zonation most likely is the result of a gas-melt interaction of the chondrules with the ambient gas while the chondrules form. So there's olivine in the core, or an olivine melt, or olivine in a melt, that interacts with the surrounding gas, which is SiO-rich, and by the reaction with the gas, the pyroxene forms. So chondrules are open systems. So studying mineralogically sown chondrules will give us clues and constraints for chondrule formation process, but also the reservoir in which these chondrules form. Therefore, it's quite important to know about these sown chondrules and about their fractions, and also about the chondrules that are not sown and what these mean. These might be reheated sown chondrules or another chondrule population or something like this. But with this kind of information, we can learn a lot about chondrule formation and their reservoir in which they formed.